Well, good evening, good afternoon, and good morning from wherever it is that you're tuning in from today. This is season 2, episode 9 now, of our International Perspectives on Corpus Technology for Language Learning seminar series, co-organized by the School of Languages and Cultures, University of Queensland, and State University of Sao Paulo in Brazil. Today, we are honored to have Professor Atsushi Mitsumoto, who's a professor at the Faculty of Foreign Language Studies in Kansai University, presenting on a topic that is going to be of interest for lots of us working on corpus-based language pedagogy, data-driven learning research, thinking about who is DDL for, thinking about the influence of learner characteristics on the effectiveness of DDL, which I think is a really timely topic. There's a lot of research going on in SLA fields at the moment about individual differences. It's really taken on a kind of resurgence with, say, complexity theory and things like that. And it's good to see an attempt to tie that in with DDL theories and DDL methodology today. So that's going to be really interesting for all of us. Before we begin, I'd just like to start by a country, which is something that we do for all public speaking engagements in Australia. And I'd just like to begin this session today by acknowledging the traditional owners and their custodianship of the lands on which we meet today, while paying our respects to their ancestors and their descendants who continue cultural and spiritual connections to country. We recognize their valuable contributions to Australian and global society. So, today's speaker, Professor Atsushi Mitsumoto, is professor at the Faculty of Foreign Language Studies and Graduate School of Foreign Language Education and Research, Kansai University, Japan. His current research interests include language learning strategies, language testing, corpus use for pedagogical purposes, which is why we invited him here today, of course, and research methodology. He's widely published in some of the top journals in our field, including Applied Linguistics, Language Learning, Language Teaching Research, Language Testing and System. And he won an award for Outstanding Academic Achievement from Language Education and Technology in 2017. We are very pleased today to have Professor Mitsumoto with us, and I hope that everybody enjoys today's talk. So the floor is now yours, and I'm going to stop sharing my screen here.
Thank you. Let me share my screen. Okay. Can everyone see it?
We can see okay. Fine.
Thank you very much for the kind introduction, Dr. Crossway. Thank you for all joining my talk. I'm very honored to be one of the speakers for this seminar series. Okay, so before I start talking about DDL, let me first introduce myself. My research interests, as Dr. Crossway said, covers a lot of a range of topics in EFL and ESL teaching and learning. And as I listed in the last item, I've also been developing web apps using mainly R and Python, and I use them in my research and teaching. Okay, and the first app, web app I introduced here is called New World Level Checker. Some of you know Vocab Profiler developed by Tom Cobb. This web app is conceptually similar and gives you the difficulty of vocabulary based on the word list selected. But with many word lists mainly developed to be used in Japanese EFL context setting, and when you copy and paste the text, you get the result like this, and you can check out the coverage of the text, and also the colored text to show how easy or difficult the text is. So it's like profiling the vocabulary used in the text. After you check out the coverage info, you can create your own list using the selected word list, and you can search, sort, or download your list. And New World Level Checker comes with a quick concordance. I wanted to include this feature because once you go to the word list function page and you cannot search where the word was used in the original text context, So newer level checker is not only a vocab profiler, but also an online concordancer. And it can be used for some DDL activities. And the next web app I introduce is AWSM. It's called AWSM. It stands for Academic Word Suggestion Machine. As you can imagine, it was named first. And AWSM is awesome. AWSM is a free online tool that provides support for English academic research writers, especially L2 writers, through an approach that integrates MOVE analysis and with the lexical bundles used in corpus research. And AWSM suggests high frequency lexical bundles, engrams for each MOVE within a section of a paper in a specific discipline. A MOVE is a rhetorical structure or things you want to write in a specific part of the specific paper in the specific section. Okay, if you type the purpose of this after selecting the abstract section of applied linguistics and presenting research MOVE in the abstract section, then the suggestions for the words to follow are displayed like this. So it shows the difference four words and on the left and four words on the right. The most frequently selected lexical bundles are displayed like this in frequency order along the right edge of the screen according to the selected section and MOVE. This lets you see which lexical bundles are most frequently used in a specific section and MOVE. And it is possible to use wildcard searches using asterisks in place of one word. And AWSM also enables you to see the usage of words in the original context. Furthermore, with Google's custom searches, you can see how words and phrases are used in academic texts, even if they are not covered by the corpus of in AWSM. Okay, and for the theoretical basis of the development of AWSM, please read this paper. The final example of my web app is called LangTest. It is very easy and intuitive to use. You simply copy and paste from your data from a spreadsheet, and you can get to see the result immediately, like the ones on the right hand. You can conduct a wide range of statistical analysis for free, and LangTest utilizes the power of flexibility of R. And since it was its release in 2013, the LangTest web application has been used worldwide. Maybe I should make some friends in Africa so that it can cover all the countries. Okay, and please read this paper for the philosophy and details of the development of the LangTest web app. Okay, I can keep talking about my apps for another 2 or 3 hours, but maybe I should stop now. Let me talk about today's topic, who is data-driven learning for, DDL4. Okay, since the term data-driven learning was proposed by Jones, there has been an increasing number of DDL studies, as you know, about, especially in the past decade. And the term DDL implies that learners search corpora by themselves, but the definition also includes hands-off uses, such as when teachers prepare concordance printouts for classroom use. But in any case, the concordance lines are always involved. So DDL's inductive discovery learning of patterns from the original definition by Jones. DDL applications have tended to be somewhat inclusive because of the label, as Bolton said, it's the original, it's data-driven, not corpus-driven. So it's the definition itself is really inclusive. Okay, and an example of this discovery and diversity can be seen in the number of DDL studies that have been conducted using like Google as corpus. Okay, and this is an example of a quick concordance line. Okay, by the way, this is just food for thought. Read the message on the screen. What do you think? Machine translation. my opinion is using MT or machine translation for learning is not DDL because, you know, but so, you know, there's no concordance lines involved. But certainly, it is online reference consultation, like online dictionaries and search engines. Okay, let me get back to DDL. In DDL research, these benefits have been suggested, proposed. Okay. Input enhancement from multiple contexts, rich exposure to authentic language use, awareness raising, noticing toward patterns and forms, cognitive and metacognitive development, heightened motivation, student centeredness, and greater autonomy. And, you know, as you know, Bolton and Crosswhite, you know, they all try to base our research on theories. So that's really good for our research field. And, you know, if you read their papers, you can clearly see they are trying to make a connection between new the theory and the DDL practice. Okay, and DDL is effective in teaching or learning lexical grammatical patterns, improving the quality of academic writing, including error correction. So it is effective for both receptive and productive purposes. And from the literature of DDL, we can conclude that it is better than traditional teaching methodologies such as explicit grammar teaching in terms of learning outcomes and perceived preferences of learners. And Bolton and Cobb's meta-analysis verified all those claims from previous DDL studies and meta-analysis And meta-analysis is a secondary research methodology to statistically combine research outcomes called effect sizes. So we think that the result obtained from meta-analysis is more rigorous empirical evidence than the primary studies. Bolton and Cobb synthesized effect sizes from 64 DDL studies from 1989 to 2014. So the total sample size was over 3,000. And they reported that for the control experimental group comparisons, like 50 studies, the combined effect size was 0.95. And for the pre-post designs was 1.5. Both suggest DDL is effective and result in considerable gains in outcome measures. These effect sizes, 0.95 for the control experimental group comparisons and 1.5 for the pre-post designs, medium to large effect based on Plonsky and Oswald's benchmarks of L2 field specific effect sizes. When comparing results from meta-analysis of instructed SLA and CORE, computer assisted language learning, the synthesized effect size of DDL is relatively large. This means that DDL is a promising teaching methodology. However, we must be careful in interpreting the results when the focus is on writing or grammar. Specifically, looking at the control experimental group comparison studies on the right-hand side, the effect size for writing is 0.28, a small effect, and the 95% confidence interval includes zero, which indicates the positive result cannot be concluded or established, or we cannot say strongly that, you know, we have that effect. And it implies that sometimes using DDL for writing could produce negative effect size. And as in writing, it also, similarly through though grammar has a moderate effect size, that's 0.62. The effect, as in writing, it also includes zero in the 95% confidence interval. Also, I should mention that for vocabulary and lexical grammar, the effect sizes are medium. That suggests DDL is useful for learning those language aspects, vocabulary and lexical grammar, lexical grammatical items. However, for grammar and discourse, the lower bound of confidence intervals is -0.25. That's pretty low. For grammar and 0.03, very, very close to zero for discourse. So we cannot say for sure that DDL works for learning these items. Okay, these inconclusive results may be due to variations of the DDL tasks. This table summarizes a wide range of DDL applications in previous studies. The hard version in this paradigm relates to more typical DDL. That's, you know, things you have in mind. And the soft version can be more conventional instruction with light DDL elements. Given the possible dimensions and continuums of DDL tasks, it is not hard to imagine that the right quorum soft DDL with guided convergent tasks in combination with teacher-led activities and a deductive instructional approach will produce better outcomes, because it is more explicit, okay? And teachers and learners know what the correct answers are when they are dealing with, you know, the tasks in soft DDL. Okay. On the other hand, hard DDL on the left column with divergent and inductive tasks such as error correction or revision in writing without any teacher support sometimes will pose a challenge to teachers and learners unless the target items are predetermined. Okay? So also such a hard DDL task will work in favor of learners with higher proficiency levels since they have an advanced level of lexicographical or grammatical knowledge. And for these reasons, it is not surprising that in Bolton and Cobb's meta-analysis, the results for writing and grammar are mixed and inconclusive. Okay. So the purpose of, you know, introducing soft DDL is to guide your learners to more, you know, hard DDL style. Okay. So this is an example of soft DDL, and a bilingual corpus was used to take into account the learner's proficiency level because the participants or the learners were had a really low proficiency level. And the target structure noun phrase is very explicit and with a fixed set of answers. So you fill in the blanks with the examples in concordance line. And this is another example of soft DDL. In this study, Korean junior high school students compare the use of B in their essays with that of native speakers of English to notice overgeneralized B. That is a typical error for Korean EFL learners, such as she is go. Moon and O reported that the paper-based soft DDL in the classroom reduced errors of overgeneralized B verbs. On the other hand, in writing, there are so many factors involved. Written corrective feedback from teachers could vary in the degree of explicitness. If learners can know which words to look for in the concordance with the feedback, they are likely to solve errors with the help of DDL. And this tends to happen with vocabulary and phrases. However, Peter reports in his study, learners tend to refer to concordance lines for solving vocabulary or phrase level, like collocation errors. But they do not do so with grammar or discourse. And the success of DDL is not guaranteed. On top of that, depending on the learner's proficiency, motivation, and their preferences, all those individual differences, they may not choose DDL. Also, in some cases, checking grammar manuals or just simply Google, you know, a Google search will be enough to correct errors. Because learners are the agents of their learning, they don't stick to DDL if they think it's not worth the effort and time. Anyway, to summarize what we know from DDL research, in general, DDL results in positive learning outcomes and positive benefits, and different types of DDL instruction are necessary depending on the proficiency or the type of learners. Guided DDL induction, soft DDL, is recommended for lower level learners. And by assisting learners, they may become autonomous in their learning in the same manner as explicit dictionary training. And introducing tools is not enough. A training session is a must, except for paper DDL studies, paper DDL practices. And DDL is not a panacea, but it is a promising alternative if used properly. That's what we can conclude, we can say from DDL research. Now, let me talk about this issue. Who is DDL for? This part is based on my research with Kiyomi Chujo. The previous argument, you know, in the field is based on the idea that DDL is inductive in nature, and as such, it's more effective for inductive learners. And it is a statement Bolton considered something of a truism. Contrary to this common belief, as DDL research and practice has evolved, as I introduced, there's now a wide variety of DDL tasks, activities, and instructions available. So as Flowerdew says, in reality, much corpus-based work also draws on the deductive approach. So some researchers think of DDL as hard DDL, where learners independently use concordances to determine rules. Others have soft DDL in mind, where teachers deductively guide learners. But obviously, the general understanding of the relationship between DDL and learning preferences requires further deeper empirical investigation. So this was the research question: which type of learner, inductive or deductive, prefers teacher-led guided induction, DDL instruction in the classroom? The participants were 145 University English as a foreign language EFL learners, science and engineering majors, and 116 males and 29 females aged 18 to 20 from a private university in Japan. The average proficiency was A2 in the Common European Framework of Reference for Languages, CFL, because it's reported that approximately 80% of Japanese university graduates are at this level. Participants in this study were considered appropriate as a target population sample, that's Japanese EFL university students. And we used three types of instruments. The first was a questionnaire on learning styles and preferences. The second was a questionnaire on DDL task values. The third was pre-post test to assess the intervention effect. And these are the items included in the questionnaires. Three items for deductive learning preferences. I'm trying to avoid saying learning styles because if you Google learning styles, myth, you know, or neurology, then you get to the results. Why I'm trying to avoid using learning styles. Anyway, and four items for inductive learning preferences, learning styles, and six items for DDL task value. And there are these are the examples of pre and post test items. As you can see, for these types of test items, the answers are pretty much fixed. So divergent items and with divergent tasks. And here's a procedure. The DDL instruction was conducted in 10 classes, 45 minutes of each 90-minute lesson. And we use bilingual corpus so that lower proficiency learners can look for patterns in concordance lines. And the target language structure was noun phrases. A four-step procedure was conducted. It was a hybrid of inductive DDL approach and a deductive grammar teaching method. you can see the similar instruction in Smart 2014. We also had a control group who received traditional deductive grammar teaching, and the pre-post-test results shows the DDL group outperformed the traditional group, traditional grammar teaching group. By comparing the two groups after controlling for the pre-test effect with ANCOVA, analysis of covariance. So this result suggests that DDL instruction was effective. And prior to the instructional intervention, DDL group participants completed the learning preference questionnaire. And following the treatment, they completed the task value questionnaire. And here's the descriptive statistics of those questionnaire items. They're okay, right? A correlation analysis was conducted to examine the relationship between DDL, that's task value here, and learning preferences, deductive and inductive. The correlation coefficient between inductive and task value was 0.20, was lower than expected, considering the common belief that the DDL is related to an inductive learning style. A similar correlation coefficient, a magnitude, was observed between deductive and task value. That's 0.21. The magnitude of the correlation coefficients was tested, and it was found that the two correlations did not differ significantly. And in these scatter plots, the center darker area shows 50% of outer lighter and outer lighter area. Shows 95% of likely data distribution if more data are added in future studies. These scatter plots also suggest that the relationship between the learning styles and task value was not so strong, and that the predictive distributions were similar for both correlations. And so we can conclude that the teacher-led guided induction of soft DDL may be beneficial for both deductive and inductive learners, irrespective of their learning preferences. And for your information, in contrast, Riddle reported that learning preferences may dictate likelihood of corpus consultation. And reflective learners who like to reflect on data were not receptive. They're not positive about the use of DDL. And because in Riddle's study, the task was to correct errors in writing with British National Corpus, and the learners were in a pre-sessional course before postgraduate study. So clearly there is an interaction effect between the learner factors, such as the level and motivation and the task, compared with our study in 2016. And obviously the treatment was different. And for this type of task, even though it was not investigated in Riddle's study, we can expect that the DDL may work better for inductive learners. So to summarize our study in 2016, guided DDL induction approach is effective for both inductive and deductive learners. And this type of DDL, soft DDL, is not only for inductive learners, but also for deductive learners. Thus, the results do not support the view that the DDL is suitable only for inductive learners. Rather, a guided DDL induction, such as the instruction used in this study, could be used to cater for learners with different learning preferences. So a guided DDL induction, such as the instruction used in our study, could be used to cater for learners with different learning preferences. I said that same thing. Okay, anyway, since the purpose of guided DDL induction approach, you know, soft DDL, is to assist learners become autonomous in their foreign language learning, guided induction could be seen as a promising methodological alternative. And learners can start from start with soft DDL and then move on to hard DDL. Also, as you can see, the task and instruction types do matter in DDL. You know, when we think about the effectiveness of DDL, it is necessary to state that DDL types like corpus, concordancer, task, and instruction, and the learner characteristics such as proficiency and individual differences in detail before making generalizable claims about the effectiveness of DDL. And because soft DDL can be an effective teaching method, this online corpus and concordancer called SCORE, maintained by Professor Nishigaki of Chiba University, Japan, could be useful for scaffolding the use of DDL for beginner level learners, especially younger ones. SCORE is a corpus with simplified sentences, so even beginner level learners can make use of the potential of DDL. Now, next, I would like to talk about another study using OSAM, which focused on learner characteristics. As I explained earlier, OSAM is a genre-based writing support tool with the corpus of top-down approach, that is MOVE analysis, and the bottom-up approach, that's lexical bundles, to raise awareness toward rhetorical structures and phrases used in academic papers, research papers. So the purpose of the study was to examine what type of learners benefit most from using OSAM for the first time. Participants were 89 undergraduate students from two private universities in Japan. And University A, the 49 students majored in English, and in University B, those 40 students majored in computer science. So their majors are different, and their proficiency ranged from A2 to B2 levels in CEFR. That means there are large differences in the proficiency among the participants. Let me now talk about procedures. In week one, students were introduced to a genre-based writing concept, and they learned the IMRAD structure and MOVEs, especially specifically MOVEs in the abstract section. And they were assigned to write the 200-word abstract by themselves. That's really challenging because they were undergraduate students and they had never written a research article paper before. So we gave them outlines of the abstract in Japanese. For English majors, the topic was on teaching communicative strategy. And for computer science majors, it was on how to better teach programming. Okay. So they had something to refer to when they were writing an abstract based on the information given in Japanese. They were writing, trying to write abstract by themselves. And in week two, the instructor checked the learner's first draft and gave them written corrective feedback. It was indirect feedback with underlining unnatural phrases. Then the instructors showed the students how to use OSAM. Students were then working on revising the abstract with the help of OSAM. They were asked not to use other resources such as online dictionaries. After revising the abstract, the students answered an online questionnaire like this. So the questionnaire items were based on the result of our previous study, and there were 5 items listing the positive aspects of using OSAM. That's confirmation of lexical grammatical items, and 2, improvement of lexical grammatical items and discovery of this lexical item. And 4, raised awareness toward the MOVE bundle connection, and 5, greater confidence and autonomy in research article writing. And one item asked the participants if they hope to keep using OSAM in the future when they need to write a research article by themselves. Okay, now let me share the result with you. I will focus briefly on three aspects. The questionnaire result, and the second is related to this question, who benefits by using Awesome and hopes to use it in the future. The third result shows qualitative changes in the phrase use by using Awesome. Okay, and this is the result of the questionnaire. As you can see, the user response was overall positive, and they most of them agreed or strongly agreed or very strongly agreed with the ideas that the Awesome, you know, by using Awesome, they can check out the concepts or ideas, aspects. Okay, and we can say that using Awesome brought about beneficial effects that the general writing pedagogy aims to achieve. The next is the question, who benefits by using Awesome and hopes to use it in the future. To answer this question, we analyze the data with decision tree analysis, and the outcome variable was the question, I will use Awesome in the future. The decision tree shows the participants on the right hand discovered phrases and their awareness toward the rhetorical structure was high because their scores were higher on the right hand. And depending on their confidence using the tool, okay, they marked higher or not. And finally, those learners who are able to confirm their knowledge of lexical grammatical items, that's like node 11, the number of participants was 8 there, because they all marked 6. So I will use Awesome in the future, very strongly agree. Okay, so, and those who marked lower for the item, I will use Awesome, deserves attention on the right hand. Okay, that node 2, now 7 students. The response for discovery was lower than 2.5 in the 6-point Likert scale. Okay, and there were 2 English majors and 5 computer science majors. And compared with other groups of learners, the proficiency level of this group was lower. And I don't know if it is appropriate to add or not in this day and age. They were all males. I often hear from my colleagues that the male students are not willing to try out new strategies introduced in the class. Probably the effect of proficiency is confounded with that of gender, because the proficiency of the male participants was lower than that of the female participants in the first place. And from open-ended responses from learners, it was found that those who marked lower on the left-hand side said they were not satisfied with how to use Awesome, difficult to use, couldn't find phrases, wanted Japanese translation. And the participants on the right-hand said they were able to make use of the tool. And so we can see that being able to use the tool has an impact on the responses of the learners. So the training session is very important because we had only one class for introducing Awesome, and it was not enough, obviously. Here I introduce some of the qualitative changes in their abstract, in the writing after consulting Awesome. As you can see, the learners were able to use more genre-specific phrases expected in the abstract of the research paper. The results the conclusion reached in this study is that it is suggested that to conclude the study revealed, the participants' programming skills very improved greatly. We analyzed the data about the growth in terms of the development. And I really like the last one, people. they started using participants or subjects. So user feedback was very positive, and also can bring about beneficial effects that the genre writing pedagogy explicitly aims to achieve. And OSAM could play a facilitating role in technology-enhanced genre writing, teaching, and learning. And learners benefited more if they have higher proficiency level and the ability to work with the tool. Their awareness toward rhetorical structure increased, and they were able to use a variety of phrases with the help of the tool. And the quality of writing improved after learning how to use the tool. So using OSAM, of course, only is not enough. A top-down and deductive teaching of genre and a training session for using the tools are crucial. And corpus approaches should be integrated within existing pedagogy rather than presented in isolation. That's what's suggested by Conrad 2000. The last comment is important because learners don't refer to concordance lines to solve all problems, as you can imagine. So we should mix the existing pedagogy. And also we need to consider mixing different types of consultation resources to make learners more autonomous in their learning. Okay, and teaching appropriate use of different resources is like a strategy training, and learners need to know how to use dictionaries and how to memorize vocabulary, you know, by learning how to learn vocabulary, how to memorize vocabulary, and how to write academic papers, and how to make use of corpus data. So everything is pretty much the same. So strategy instruction is all about empowering our learners. At the same time, in the study I just talked about, the problem of lower proficiency level learners persisted. So we need to help them with appropriate scaffolding. Finally, I think if we think about the number of DDL publications in recent years, studies unveiling learners' individual differences, few and far between. As I said, we should put much more emphasis on learners because they are the ones who use DDL for their learning in the long run, because we still don't know which individual difference factor or factors on DDL should be investigated. I think we still have a long way to go. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Professor Mizumoto. We'd like the questions to come through in the chat. So far, I've only received one question, but that's so a little unusual there. But obviously, I'd like to thank you for presenting today for us. And I'm sure that everybody else in the audience, and we've got an audience of 94 people, including us, which is great. I'd like to thank you on behalf of our audience today. Obviously, you can't hear the applause over Zoom, but it is definitely coming through. Lots of thanks there coming through in the chat. And I will stop the recording here in preparation for the Q&A. Although, I think I'll keep the recording going on for the Q&A. Before I do that, I just need to bring something up. But while I'm working on that, I will just ask a question, first of all, from one of the audience attendees, that is Jasper Chin. They would like to create a corpus tool of their own, but they're wondering which programming languages should they learn to do this. What's your advice? And I guess that you already have an answer ready to go.
Yeah, it must be Python. I suggest Python. We have Lawrence Anthony, Professor Anthony in our audience, so you know he knows much more about it, and you know he's now programming AntKong and other related tools with Python from scratch. So you know, that's a lot of work, and I really thank him for doing that. But definitely Python is really fast, and I suggest that, you know, you should give it a try.
Thank you very much. And that actually provides me with my segue into next week's and the final presentation in this season of the International Perspectives on Corpus Technology for Language Learning Seminar Series. Dr. Lawrence Anthony, Director of the Center for English Language Education in Science and Engineering at WASADA, another presenter tuning in from Japan, and of course needs very little introduction, but doing our final presentation next week for an introduction to ANCONC for addressing the challenges of data-driven learning through corpus tool design. So I guess that ties in very nicely with the question asked by our previous questioner, I guess you'd call them. But yes, that is coming up very, very soon. So do look out for that. We've got now, Lawrence has a different answer. So this is in an answer for the previous question. It really depends on if you want to create desktop tools or online tools. And I guess that is very sage advice there. Question from Martin then coming through. Martin, and he's also in Japan. How many of the university students had experience of corpora prior to the study? Had any been introduced to it while at school? Ideally, the earlier the better. What are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, not so many of them have experience using corpora before, prior to the study, definitely. But online dictionaries sometimes come with concordance functions, concordance line functions. So maybe they have seen some of them, but they're not, you know, like trying to use it by themselves.
Okay. But obviously, this is something that I've been trying to work on for a number of years now, and maybe this is something that yourself could have a go at, maybe looking at some of the schools in your area and try and get out with them. Is that something that you've considered?
I'm sorry, what's the question? Sorry, I couldn't catch
it. Oh, this is a question from me, I guess, is like, have you considered trying to visit maybe some local schools and seeing what they think?
Oh yeah, we have you know, like as I said, Professor Nishigaki and her colleagues have been working on introducing DDL to elementary school kids and students. So, but that's really soft DDL, you know, deductive and really divergent, with divergent tasks. So, so we can see that their reactions are really positive. So, you know, we have a possibility of proliferating or introducing DDL at an early age.
Thank you very much. I've got another question from Nikolaos. And he asks, what are the reasons for the interplay between the proficiency level and the benefits coming from the use of the tool? So lots to talk about here, potentially. What are your thoughts on this?
Interplay between the proficiency level and the benefits coming. Yeah, you know, if the task is hard DDL, and you know, like they have to search for answers by themselves, then you know, their proficiency plays very important role. Okay. So that's, you know, clearly we know that proficiency is important. In the more proficient our learners, the better they can make use of the DDL. That's my answer.
Have I guess question? Yeah, I suppose it does, but in a way it also raises a question of why. How, and I think this has come up in some of the other talks and as well, in how do we reach lower level learners through DDL? What kind of things do they need to be doing to make the best use of it? In that, there's an argument that in only having success with higher proficiency students, that then it's not really going to catch on across the board, because we're leaving out students who might well benefit, but at the moment, current situation, the current resources or the current tools are not, the current corpora themselves are not set up to allow younger or lower level learners to get into this. So what needs to be done to improve that situation?
Yeah, so the corpus and the software developers have to work harder to reach more audience, definitely.
Okay.
Yeah.
Is there anything you can think of, say, within the tool itself or within the data that would allow that to happen?
I think I remember Lawrence, Professor Anthony once said that the ideal, the best tool is Google search. You just type something and then you get to see the result. So the simpler, the better.
The simpler, the better. Right. I've got another question now from Alex Bolton, who's here tonight. He was the
Alex, long time no see.
Presenter in our first season and tunes in most of the episodes. His question says, if he understands right, you found DDL was appropriate for both inductive and deductive learning styles. Others have found similar things on different dimensions. However, DDL does not work for everyone equally. There are certainly differences in uptake and benefits. If it's not a question of learning styles, which again, I don't think it is either, what type of individual differences explain the variation? So, you know, if we could make a list of these individual differences, you've got common things like age, gender, proficiency level. Of these, which do you think it's kind of more susceptible or more appreciative of DDL, or which are kind of left out?
Okay, that's really a good question. And I think, of course, proficiency is important, but, you know, we don't want to give up on DDL because of, you know, the only the high proficiency learners can make use of it. So we want to try to introduce DDL to lower level learners. And sorry, maybe I should check out here. Maybe self-confidence and, of course, motivation. And, you know, like for undergraduate students, they are really motivated to write papers, research papers. Undergraduate students who take English classes as a compulsory subject, they are not really so highly motivated to use DDL for their learning. And from my students' research, she found the nationality matters, and because maybe that's based on their beliefs about how useful DDL could be, and you know, and more. And so maybe we need to, you know, pinpoint what could affect DDL.
Yeah.
You know, among all those individual differences.
Yeah. I think another thing, and I guess I'm just adding on to this answer, is that as we're seeing with a lot of kind of individual difference research at the moment, or thinking about complexity theory, for example, is that things change over time. So you'll have learners who are initially quite invested into DDL and quite interested in it, and for whatever reason they burn out or they become disillusioned with it. Maybe they tried to revise their text or something, they didn't get good feedback from their teacher, then they felt, well, what a waste of time, you know, I'll just go back to what I was doing before. Or maybe there's a specific exam coming up that they need to do, a specific task which is really useful, which then gets them back into doing something like that. These things are not fixed, and it takes kind of a good teacher to be able to manage a lot of the things that are going on in the classroom to enable mm-hmm. this to work. Like any computer-assisted language learning innovation or even any kind of pedagogical approach, it takes careful management, and it what might work one day might not work the next day, and I think that's something that we really have to take care of. Yeah, so cool. I'll move on to a question from Sisu Ricci. This is a question about R Shiny programming. How do you transfer R Shiny local server to your own website server? Do you apply the Docker technology? Thanks a million. And remember that you don't have to answer this question if this is something that you've got to keep secret, but how do you do it? Because I just checked out the web. I mean, I've known about this website for some time. I just checked it out again now, and it's like, wow, that's great. And we have people working on this ourselves who might be very interested in how that works. So can you provide a bit of an explanation about how you do it?
Yeah, if you have your own server, you can set it up really easily, because that was set up, that was installed in, like, you know, I started using it in 2013, and there was no Docker technology. No. So back then. So I just installed it in my server, and it was working okay. Yeah, it's been working okay.
Yeah, I mean, it seems to work just fine. I think, but some R experts seem to be confused about how it works. But that's good. It is really good. It's great that we're able to share that resource with everybody today. Do check it out. Particularly the stat stuff is really incredibly useful, as is the awesome resource. So that is all the questions for today. I'd like to thank Professor Atsushi Mizumoto for presenting today. I hope that you've all had a wonderful time. It's been a really interesting talk, lots of practical advice and lots of food for thought for future research. But again, I'm going to cut the recording here, and do look out for the recording on our website as well as on YouTube within the next 24 hours period. Thanks again. Any final comments for us, Professor Mizumoto?
Don't work too hard.
Hey, you got that right. Don't work too hard. Enjoy your corpora, enjoy your corpus linguistics, enjoy your research, enjoy your DDL, enjoy your Easter, what's left of it. And thanks very much. Adriana, any final words here for tonight?
Yeah, just like to thank Professor Mizumoto for the great presentation. And I'm glad to see that there are more tools coming in, because I think that in the past few years, a lot of tools have been developed based on DDL. I'm also developing one in Portuguese as well to teach collocations. There'll be corpus-based games and activities, and it targets beginners as well, because I think that a lot of teachers focus on intermediate level students and advanced students, and I think it's important to target beginners as well. So I'd like to thank you for sharing that. I'll take a look at the tool and see if I can have some more ideas based on yours as well. Thank you very much for your talk.
That's exciting. Yeah, looking forward to try out your tools.
Yeah, I'll share that in the future with you.
Yeah, cool.
All right, thanks everybody. We're gonna close it up for tonight. Thanks again.